all these big guys, you know, they could hardly see me.
Arnie, did any of you, for anyone on the team, was it, did any of you notice?
I didn't know he was Japanese. It was really a non-issue with us. Mm-hmm. My dog and I came down and played basketball together.
Well, we had a pretty compatible group in 47, too. I remember, you know, we'd sing those old cowboy songs. Don't Fence Me In was our favorite song back in those days. We'd sing in the shower.
Singing with Arnie must have been a treat.
He's well known in this family for his musical ability.
He didn't have the loudest voice. Lee Watson and Vern, yeah, they used to really, especially Vern, he's from Wyoming, so.
There's Arnie. There's me.
You just flip down there so she get one of the basketball players in the car. You got Vadel.
I was.
What her name was?
That's Jean Fleming.
Oh, that's Jean Fleming.
Okay. It seems like I recognize her. You go to school, and I said, well, I plan to do that.
And that's my little friend that I go down with.
She's got the children. Send you to school, but she said if you go to Weber College, said you could walk to school and you could live here. And so she said if you could just find some way to pay your tuition. She says,
with his dad.
I think we could make it that way. Of course, I worked in the summertime, so that earned enough to pay the tuition, which wasn't very much.
Before, and only noticed Arnie.
Of course, I got a part-time job up at the gymnasium there, and so that helped pay for the incidentals. She was happy with that. But, and I don't know what happened with my brothers. So.
But they all got to school, didn't they?
Of course, they didn't.
They all graduated from college?
Taps did, but Oscar didn't. Oscar went to Weber.
Oh, did he?
And then he had to admit that wasn't completely true. Oh. So I had to take an extra quarter to finish getting enough credits. I ended up, I think 187 hours is what it needed to graduate, and I ended up with like 215 or something total.
Overachiever, right?
Yeah, well.
And you graduated with a degree in engineering?
Engineering, mechanical engineering. I remember the counselor told me you might get a school teaching job, you know, in engineering. But that was before the war, and mm-hmm. So science wasn't a very popular subject. And they said, you know, don't you think you want to try something else besides engineering? And I thought, well, that's what I'll be in. I signed somewhere because I'd always been pretty good in math, so I thought I'd better stay in engineering.
Good.
Kind of wish that I would have gone into dentistry or something, huh? our dentist friends, they all done quite well.
I think it's interesting, isn't it? Sam, I'd not heard all of this. I just thought Vadel gave it. And I was the only one that didn't get one.
I'm going to listen to the tape.
But he'd been cut. But from what I understand, he went to see that Irish and, you know, says, I've got two kids. I don't know what I'm going to do if I can't get to, you know, don't get to play, so on and so forth. And I'd heard that that was one of the reasons why. And also, I don't think that he felt like I was quite the drawing card that he had anticipated. Mm. He had two Jewish fellows on the team to help with that, you know, with the local
yeah, there wasn't fans. Japanese population in the city, was there?
No, not much. But anyway, that's just another angle. You know, I don't know if there's any truth in it or not.
Well, I just, as have today. You see good players that don't stay, and the reason is that there really isn't a place for them when they come in as a rookie.
Yeah.
Josh, ask them. I find crazy things fascinating, like the way that the coaches could not coach you, that kind of stuff.
Oh, well, somebody asked me the other day, what play did you set up for her to make the winning basket? I said, we didn't have any plays.
Oh. It was mostly, you focused on the defense, right?
Yeah, Herb didn't. In fact, he didn't want to shoot that.
Really? He didn't pass it?
And time running out, so he just fired away.
But that the coaches couldn't coach you.
Right, they had to stay on the sidelines.
We
call them our own plays.
Mm-hmm. Well,
sometimes after the game, we didn't want to
coach. I'm saying, we're looking there.
Yeah, and you know, during timeouts, too. We had to stay out on the floor during timeouts. Mm-hmm. Sit around the circle out.
So how did you feel going there? Did you feel like, you could win?
One was the game, so Beta wasn't mad.
Oh, emotional blackmail.
The other thing that I find interesting was the way the lives went for the team that was hurt and your team. The way
under the basket, the alternated players.
Do you have the article about the Arkansas team?
I know.
About what happened.
That's what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. That's what I found fascinating.
Have you heard about the jacket? I've read this article about the jacket of the Arkansas team. The coach of the team had this jacket.
I told him about it.
And tell what?
Well, apparently, I read this, so I don't know if this is apocryphal or whatever. But I read that initially Vadel didn't want to take opportunity out of despair from someone else. But the coach, the coach's family called him and asked him
the Arkansas coach's family
to participate, and if he would take a jacket that the coach had traditionally worn to the games, a red jacket, and if he would wear it to the games. And according to the story, Vadel did so, and the jacket was lost to time until recently, when children found it, and
Vadel's children
found it and presented it to
Coach Jack.
And he's now wearing a red jacket on, at some of the
games.
He worked at the game against BYU recently.
Yeah, I've seen that jacket. It's bright red.
Yeah.
Did you know that Vadel wore it?
No, I don't remember that.
Yeah.
I don't remember it either.
We may have to.
I don't remember the.
That's a good story.
It is a good story.
urban myth, urban legend.
It could be.
But that was that reporter that he was working for the North Carolina paper when he called us. That was in 1994, was it? 50 years afterwards, anyway.
When he wrote the article about Arkansas?
Well, yeah. Mm-hmm. And he was in, where's that, Fayette?
New York?
Arkansas.
Oh.
He was in Arkansas as a reporter back in those days. Mm. And in the meantime, he'd moved to North Carolina. But then he wanted to follow up on that story, and he knew the whole bit. And so he called Arnie and talked to Arnie, and then Arnie sicked him on to me like he usually does.
Yeah.
And that was the first time that we'd heard the whole story, about the guy losing his leg, and they brought the leg to the coach, and the coach didn't know what to do with it the next day, and he went out and buried it out into the field or something. Mm. It was kind of gruesome. But,
One player died in the accident?
It was the coach that died, wasn't it?
The assistant coach. He really wasn't an assistant. He was just doing them a favor by driving the car.
And as I told Trace, the comparison of the lives of the Arkansas players for not having the opportunity to maybe win a national championship they all were kind of sordid, and an alcoholic, and some died of diseases, and someone tried to make the comparison between the life successes of the kids that we played with. Mm-hmm. All of them really were fairly successful in what they did. And the Arkansas people, and the question then was, do you think that by playing on the NCAA championship team, it impacted what you did the rest of your life? And do you think by them not being able to, maybe you can impact on them for the rest of their life? And I don't, you can probably even draw that conclusion. But it's impacted your life. Well, it really has. I told somebody the other day, I think that, run the parade. If I'd been a basketball player, I would have gotten to run the parade. Well, maybe I married Pat.
That's what it was.
That might have been the reason. I think that's the reason I was on the NCAA basketball committee, because I played in the NCAA tournament.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's probably where the Lakers drafted me. But they didn't have any scouts.
Mm-hmm.
I asked them where I'd fit in. They said, you're a good player. You'll fit in. So, no question, particularly in my life, that playing on that basketball team.
You know, as we continue our little project, the first two stories that came to mind, obviously yours, is we had to. And Watts, because we thought your story was unique. But as we talk to other players, to your knowledge, are there other unique stories on that team?
Well, I told you, the only person I know of who played in the NBA, Fred was in medical school,
mm-hmm.
and played the home games for the Philadelphia Warriors and didn't travel. I don't know anybody else that was good enough that a team would sign him and just let him play the home games while he was finishing medical school.
Yeah.
Did Fred Wagner in 47?
No, Fred Sheffield.
Fred Sheffield, okay.
He was in medical school, I think, at Temple.
They played the home games there. That's interesting.
Yeah, he played just the home games and didn't travel.
Didn't play with Bert?
Well, yes, except he wasn't going to school.
Right.
He was schooling, so he couldn't travel, but they signed him anyway. And he played quite a little bit for them, but just at home.
It'd be tough to get that kind of deal this day.
Well, Herb could have played, except that they wouldn't.
Well, they saw he was with us for 2 or 3 weeks.
Oh, he was?
But he wouldn't. And the interesting part of that, which I didn't know, it always been interesting, Herb didn't want to play on Sundays, but said he'd stay in the hotel room if they needed him, he'd come and play. So he's LDS, and I'm playing every Sunday. I wasn't sure what the reference was, but subsequently I found that he'd been called on a mission. And I think he'd been set apart as a missionary. And so when he went back there, he'd been set apart as a missionary.
Back to New York for the...
No, to Minneapolis.
Minneapolis, okay.
And so he was there, I don't know, 2 or 3, maybe a month. He practiced and played some games with us, but didn't really like to... that didn't sit very well on Sundays. And from there, it'd be interesting to talk to him about. From there, he went to England. And I think in England, they wanted him to play for the English national team. I don't think his mission president let him, but they sent him up to Norway or Sweden or somewhere where he coached the Olympic team.
Hmm. Interesting,
yeah.
So, Arnie, did you realize it was this? So incredible that you guys were doing it, or were you just, I mean, how did you feel?
You know, I already, we played a lot of games. I didn't think at the time, I played the tournament won it, and it was neat.
Do you feel the same way?
Did
you feel like it was something special
right?
You guys were doing?
18-year-old kids take everything.
Oh, yeah.
Did people treat you different when you came back? I mean, people you knew?
Kissed their feet.
Yeah.
Threw a brain.
Yeah, we knew that. But
for me, you know, my whole life changed. You know, And Arnie's gone on and done great things after that. But for the rest of us, you know, that kind of was the highlight of our careers. And it happened a long time ago, and here we are.
People flying in from Japan to talk to him about it.
Right.
This last year. 60 years after?
Well, you know, that one fellow a couple years ago that came from Japan that interviewed you, well, he said he finally finished that book, so there's a book over there in Japanese.
That's great.
I don't know.
Maybe I'll translate it for you.
Yeah, well, that's what he said.
32 years old.
Yeah, well, he gets a lot of money. Well, anyway, so, you know, great things are still happening. And it's something that has affected our lives, even though it's happened over 60 years ago, you know.
But did you realize the impact at the time when one?
No.
No, I think that was Jeff's question. I didn't either. I thought, oh, we were in a basketball, we were in a tournament, you know. Played in high school, won games in my high school, and
that's what you did.
But like
that's what we did.
In 47, you know, we kept thinking, well, isn't it neat that we could win this championship during our centennial year, you know? And then Utah winning its national championship, and we're having our centennial year days in 47.
We just killed everybody. Won all three games by 7 points.
Yeah.
Grandpa Arn, didn't see you play in high school?
I don't think so. I remember one of the things he came to, I'm not sure he got there, but Lieutenant Colonel in the ROTC, we had the season in, but I think he came there, but he came, I think I told you that, I'm not sure they sell any home games, but they come to New York, because we could sell our tickets for $30 a piece at Brooks Brothers. Everybody had enough money to enjoy living, and he and Lulu would come. I didn't give you my tickets to that. Financial disaster when they came to watch us play.
Yeah, well, Tetzel came up from Washington, so I didn't have any money.
In New York?
Yeah. Yeah, I was in the service with him. And in fact, when we were stationed in St. Paul, he and I were dating sisters.
You're kidding.
Well, later on he ended up marrying that gal, but when we went to New York in 47, he was working for the government, Bureau of Reclamation or something, in Washington. Well, he was living in Maryland, working in Washington, D.C. So he came up to New York to watch us play. So,
your $60.
I think he slipped on the floor.
I enough money to last all summer.
And I gave him tickets to go to the game, and so when I went back to try for the Knicks and got cut, I went down to see him before I came back home. When I first played, he took me out to the driving range and when I first hit any golf balls.
Sorry you did that, aren't you?
Yeah.
Well, you know, there's, we really appreciate you taking time with. I know you guys have had people come to you before talk about doing things, and I don't know what this will turn into, but I think it's something that's important that it's remembered correctly. We wanted to do this because it's, you know, meant a lot to us in our lives, and we want to share that with other people. So if you don't mind, we'd love to be able to call you if we have questions.
Okay.
Maybe a lot.
We'll see how it goes. Change my story.
We'll give you a chance to change it back if you want to. So no worries about that.
What is your? Do you mind if Josh calls you up?
No, not at all.
What's your phone number?
You're calling during the day, still working, asking how much money is making.
And 295-9624.
And he's struggling a little bit for a minute.
Well, that's my home number.
Well, you're working for her too.
So he'll
yeah.
Talk to Katie.